And that leads one to ask this question: what is the church really prepared to do about it? Here were lepers who did something. Now I want to be perfectly personal and direct. I believe that there are many within these walls who are conscious of the desperate need of the land today. And they will subscribe to the conviction that revival is the only answer, that a manifestation of God is the only answer to the problem. That is your conviction. Well, that was the conviction of the lepers. If we stay here, we die. We'll do something about it. In other words, we'll take a risk. And in the economy of grace, blessed be God, there are no risks. They did something about it. Now tell me, what are we really prepared to do about it? Let's face ourselves with unqualified honesty. Let us stand in the full blaze of the searching beam of God. I'm talking about revival. I'm interested in revival. I'm aware of the desperate situation. What am I doing about it? I wonder if I may ask one question. How much time did you spend today in prayer that God might visit the land? That God might come in revival power and in revival blessing. Measure your sincerity and your honesty, yes, your Christian experience, by that. I have said frequently recently that it is my deep-seated conviction that much that goes under the name of church activity, and I say this as a Presbyterian minister, is just a laughing stock of devils. We are not sincere. We don't act according to what appears to be our convictions. If I really was concerned, if I really viewed the situation as heaven must view it today, why every moment at my disposal would be spent in pleading the promises of God? That's Christianity. That's God in the soul. That's the life force of Jesus making itself manifest through my mortal flesh. But my dear people, are we there? Oh, you may say what a dear lady said about my preaching some little time ago. I was asked to address a conference of women outside of London. Never an easy conference to address. However, I was there for a week, the only male among them. After one sermon or address, the lady, a titled lady, the wife of a lord, she was heard to say a very interesting address, but we must not forget that the dear man was born and brought up among the hills of Scotland, and he has a theology of his own. No, this is the word, and I believe the message that the Church of Jesus Christ stands in need of in this desperate hour, that the Church of God will face reality and will face sincerity. He that doeth truth, or in other words, he that is truthful will come to the light. Notice further that there is here also a consciousness of obligation.
We do not well. This is a day of glad tidings. Of course it is. A day when God wills to outpour His Spirit. If my people call by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my faith, then I in heaven will hear and will come, I'm quoting from the Gaelic, and will come and heal the land. That's the God that we worship. That's the God that we believe in. My dear people, this is the day of grace. This is the hour of Pentecostal reality. I've said repeatedly recently, if Pentecost cannot be repeated, if visitations such as was witnessed by the early church following Pentecost cannot be repeated, then we are living in a day when the Word of God holds no pattern or precedent. But we are living in that day. We are living in the day of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit that hath been outpoured. But oh, for men and women so in the hands of the Holy Ghost and so possessed by the Spirit that they will recognize that this is indeed an hour of glad tidings. We have a message. We have an answer to the problems that confront the church, yes, and the world today. The God is forgotten. That is an arresting passage in the prophecy of Isaiah. Your sins and your iniquities have sent God into hiding. What sin? What iniquity? The sin and the iniquity of His people. And I make bold to say again that there is only one thing that hinders revival in Canada today, and that is the sin of God's people. Revival doesn't begin among the ungodly, of course it doesn't. It begins among the people of God, if my people call by my name. If they would do something. Oh, here were lepers, and they did something about it. And because they did something about it, the situation was saved. Oh, let me say again, the man who has eyes to see is today gazing upon ominous shadows of slanted world that is ripening for repentance or judgment. Repentance! Oh, that the word may ring through the Christian church. Repentance! Repentance is a saving grace whereby a sinner, out of a true sense of sin and apprehension of the mercy of God, doth with grief and hatred turn from it. If my people turn from it and seek my faith, oh, let me repeat it, words that are pregnant with meaning. I in heaven will listen. But why is he not listening? Why is he not listening? Why is he not coming down? Why is the land not healed? Because the church is asleep. Regardless of the multitudes that are perishing, as represented by Samaria here, a famine, a desperate situation. If there is one thing above another, that the Church of Jesus Christ needs today, it is surely, oh, it is surely a sense, a gripping sense of an engrossing purpose. Why is the Church in existence? Why was it called into being? Surely to propagate the message of the gospel. Surely to honor God in the midst of men. I wonder how many of us believe that the character of God is committed to his people. Believe that? Committed to his people. Committed to his church. When they fail, he fails in the eyes of the average man of the world. Oh, tell me, dear people, are we truly representing God? Are we showing a concern? Are we gripped by fundamental convictions that unless a man is born again, he will be doomed and damned forever? My dear people, how many of us believe in hell? I'm glad you're going to discuss it. How many of us believe it? It seems to me that few in the Christian church today really believe in the doom of the damned. Could we sleep if we did? Could we rest if we did? Would the prayer meeting be so empty? And listen, you do not judge the life vitality of any congregation by what you see on Sunday morning. Of course you don't. That's not the criteria. That is not the evidence of spirituality. You go to the prayer meeting on Wednesday or Thursday. That's the evidence. That's the evidence. That's the measure of your impact. That's the measure of your interest in revival. That's the measure of your vision relative to the desperate need of the country. That's the measure. Oh, let's face it this morning. Let's face it with honesty and sincerity. Listen to the words of Scripture. I send thee to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God. My dear people, this is the conviction. Oh, this is the conviction that gives purpose and gives direction to the true child of God. I read somewhere, I think it was from Boston's fourfold state, that great book that comes down to us from the Puritan period. This is what Boston said. No man is born into the world whose work is not born with it. Suggesting that God has a plan. Young folk, are you listening? That God has a plan. And that God has a purpose. Why is it that so few young men today are offering for foreign mission work? Why is it that so few young men are willing to go out to the villages and the country districts of Canada to proclaim the unsearchable riches of Christ? Just because they have no sense of purpose or a heaven-given direction. They are not aware of the fact that God has a plan and that God has a purpose. That every man's life is a plan of God. No, I'm not prepared to depart from my ambition. Let the multitudes go to hell, my ambition. My security. My stated salary. God help us. God help us. Is that the spirit of the Christian? Is that the spirit of the man who is willing to face the implications of Calvary? No. The cry of his heart is, take the world, but give me Jesus. So that the day will come when through my sacrificial giving of myself, I shall come before him with jewels that will sparkle as diamonds in the coronet of his eternal glory. And there, because there came an hour in my experience when I faced reality, stood before the implications of Calvary, and cried, I am going through, Jesus. I am going through. I will pay the price whatever others do. I'll go the way of the world despite of you. I started out, Jesus. I'm going through. I was in a room one day. A young woman came into the room. And she knelt at the couch beside me. She's weeping bitter, weeping bitter. And she cried, Mr. Campbell, I'm in my Gethsemane. I'm in my Gethsemane. What was it? She was engaged to a young minister. A young minister that certainly will make his name in the church. He had asked her hand in marriage. One night, she's kneeling in prayer in her own room. She couldn't tell me whether she fell asleep or fell into a trance. She couldn't tell me. But she heard the wail of the damned, the wail of the masses, in Congo. In Congo. And that night, in her Gethsemane, she said no to the hand offered her and gripped the hand of the man of Calvary. Since then, that young girl has been instrumental in leading hundreds to Christ. She's waiting for Congo to open to her, and she'll be back there the moment the door opens, with many others out waiting to get in. Why do I tell you that story? Was it easy? Was it easy to put that hand aside with all that it meant and all that it promised? God may not ask you to do that, but he asked you to face the implications of Calvary. Oh, we're so unwilling to face the cross. We want an easy path. Was the path of the Master easy? I often think of him there in that struggle in the wilderness. The enemy comes to him. The kingdoms of the world. Demonstrate your power. Throw yourself down. Turn the stones into bread and the world will follow you. And I sometimes wonder if Jesus at that moment didn't just pause for a second. And then he lifted his eyes. He looked down toward Gethsemane and he saw the bitter cup. He lifted his eyes and he saw Calvary with its shame and death. But I venture to say that his eyes rose higher. And he saw a city that hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. He saw the redeemed host. He listened to their singing. They're singing the song of Moses and of the Lamb. And he knew that if he failed in that hour, that song would never be sung. Get thee behind me, Satan. And he set his face steadfastly to go to Jerusalem, making possible the good tidings. I lay beside, at least a few yards from a Highlander, young man of the 42nd Highlander, at the Battle of Passchendaele. He's wounded, badly wounded in his right arm. He's doing his best to stem the flow of blood. Indeed, I saw him tear his shirt to try and bandage the wound. But as he works at this wounded arm, he's looking across that bloody field. And there in front of him, he saw a young man with the tartan of the 42nd Highlanders, the Black Watch. I heard him say, "Boys, I'm sure that's Chuck Blair Gowrie. I'm sure that's Chuck Blair Gowrie." And then as I watched that wounded comrade out there, I saw a hand being lifted, as though beckoning for help, or beckoning for someone to give him a drink. Then I saw this young man springing to his feet, and in face of the enemy's fire, cry, "That's Chuck Blair Gowrie, and I'll save him or die in the attempt." And he saved him. He saved him. Oh, for that spirit. Oh, for that caliber. Oh, for that sense of purpose and conviction. I'll save them. Take the world, but give me Jesus. Take ambition and security. Oh, take it, take it, take it all. But let me be instrumental in saving souls that will sparkle as diamonds in the coronet of his eternal glory. Are we there, dear people? Oh, are we there? This is a day of glad tidings. And we hold our peace. The crime. Oh, the crime of being silent. Am I speaking to criminals today? Am I speaking to criminals? In face of the need, in face of the desperate situation, silent. Oh, may God forgive us. I'm sure some of you must have heard of the great Dr. Thomas Chalmers, the leader of the disruption from the Church of Scotland in 1843, when the great Free Church of Scotland came into being, that became the great missionary church of our beloved land. This movement was led by Thomas Chalmers. They left their manses, they left their churches, because they refused to bow to the establishment or patronage. They came right out, hundreds of them, founded the church. Dr. Chalmers is visiting the northeast of Scotland in the interest of the church, and on this occasion is staying in one of our country hotels in that part of our land. After supper, the proprietor came to the doctor and said, "Dr. Chalmers, will you lead us in worship?" It was their custom, of course, as it is the custom there, to have worship after supper, even in hotels. He was asked to take the book, as it is commonly referred to. And while reading the chapter, he was suddenly gripped by the conviction that he should speak to the proprietor about his soul. The proprietor was a God-fearing man. He wasn't a Christian, but he was a man who read the Bible and insisted upon family worship every evening.
something said to Thomas Chalmers, "Now speak to the man." They went on their knees and Chalmers prayed, and as he prayed, this conviction seemed to grip him. But another voice spoke, and the other voice said, "There are quite a lot of guests in the hotel tonight, and the staff are very busy, including the proprietor himself. Just wait for a more opportune moment. You'll be back again in the near future, and you can take time to talk to him then." Now this is in Chalmers' diary. He went to his room and retired to rest, sleeping until about midnight, when a disturbance in the hotel woke him. Couldn't understand it. But on coming down to breakfast, he was told that at 11:20, the proprietor had died of a heart attack. Dr. Chalmers tells us that he went back to his room, couldn't think of breakfast, buried his head in the pillow, and cried, "It was, my God, an opportune moment, but I missed it. It was an opportune moment, but I missed it. This is a day of glad tidings." Oh, are we missing the opportunity that is ours? I believe that God is calling for men, especially young men, who will get into the battle with this battle cry, "I'll save them or die in the attempt." I'm sure that was the thought in the mind of the poet when he penned the words, "Give me men to match my mountains, give me men to match my plains. Men with empires in their purpose, men with eras in their brains. Give me men to plead for nations, like Elijah on his knees, who in hours of death-like stillness waits to catch that heavenly breeze. Give me men of faith and vision, stripped of every earthly gaze, till across our parched valley, dark will roll God's clouds of rain." Oh, give us such men.
And to all generations, wilt thou not revive us again, that thy people may rejoice in thee? It was suggested to me that I should tell you a little this evening of the gracious movement of God's Holy Spirit that began in the northwest of Scotland in December of 49 and continued for over 3 years. The movement known as the Hebridean Revival. Now let me say right at the beginning that that revival did not begin by my going to Lewis. It has grieved me again and again to hear reference made to me as the man that brought revival to Lewis. Now I don't carry revival with me in my pocket. Revival began in the Hebrides before I ever set foot on the island. And tonight I'm going to tell you how that gracious movement began. It began in a prayer burden. And that poor burden came to two elderly women living in a little cottage in the parish of Barbados on the island of Lewis. Two sisters, one 82 and the other 84 years of age. They were led to the Lord 60 years ago through one of our workers laboring then on the island of Lewis by the name of Miller, who for many years was a director in the African Inland Mission and is still closely associated with it. They, one evening, felt led to raise upon God in prayer. They have been burdened for quite a while because of the stream of genuine, vital Christianity being running so low in the parish. It was a fact that hardly a young person attended a public worship. It's true that they read their Bible, they had family worship in their home, but seldom darkened the door of a church. And this was very disturbing to the two sisters and also to the minister and his office bearer. They had special efforts, special evangelists were brought to the parish, missions were conducted over the years, but back from every endeavor they came with a sense of battling and frustration. This particular night, while the two sisters waited upon God in prayer, a vision came to one of them. Now, strange things happen in revival. Things that you cannot explain on the basis of the human. A vision came to one of the sisters. She couldn't tell me whether she had fallen asleep on her knees, and the vision came to her then, or whether she fell into a trance during the prayer period, and the vision came then to her. She couldn't be sure about that. But this is the vision that she had. She saw the church of her fathers crowded with young people. She saw a strange minister in the pulpit, and through that vision, she was convinced that God was speaking to her and revealing that revival was going to visit not only their parish, but the whole of the Western Isles. She sent for the minister and told the minister her story and suggested to him that he and his office bearer should give themselves to waiting upon God in prayer. Wait, he said, upon God until God reveals why revival is not coming to the parish. The minister, a wise man, listened to the words of this dear woman, a real prophetess. He called his office bearers together, and it was decided on the suggestion of one of the sisters that 2 nights a week should be spent waiting upon God in prayer. They would kneel in a little cottage at Barbet Cross Road, and the minister and his office bearer at the other end of the parish on Tuesday and Friday night. So they gave themselves to waiting upon God in prayer. Weeks passed, months passed, and nothing happened. The churches were as empty. The young people of the parish are indifferent. The drinking houses closed, places of entertainment crowded, but very little thought of God. Until one night, miracle, miracle. A young man in the group of all his bearers stood up and read from Psalm 24. Who shall ascend the hill of God? Who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing of the Lord. Not just a blessing. There are a great many people, and thereafter a blessing. You may be here this evening, and you're after a blessing. But here were men, at least one young man, seeking the blessing of the Lord. He looked down at the minister and the other of his bearers, they're kneeling among straw in a barn. And in very crude language he addressed them. They don't appear so crude in the Gaelic language. It's a little softer than your English. He said this, "It seems to me just so much humbug to be paying as we are paying, to be waiting as we are waiting, since we ourselves are not rightly related to God." He lifted up his arms toward the heavens and cried, "God, are my hands clean? Is my heart pure?" And that young man got no farther with his prayer. He knelt, and then a strange thing happened. Something that startled the minister who had never seen it before. This young man fell into a trance. Now, as I frequently say, please do not come to me after this vision and ask me questions about the physical manifestations of this moment, because I cannot answer your questions. I could not understand the physical manifestation, but of this I am certain, God was in it. When that young man fell into this trance, a power was let loose in the parish that shook the Hebrides. Though I wasn't there was no public intimation of any meetings to be held in any of the churches, but on the following day the churches were crowded. Crowded by whom? Crowded by men and women seeking after God. The miracle had happened. God had taken the field. This is not a special effort. This is not a crusade. This is not an evangelistic campaign organized and sponsored by men and by churches. This is God getting into the field. The God of miracles and the God of a revival. And the following day, the minister called on the two sisters. And they knew that something had happened. They too, at that particular hour, when this was happening in the barn, were strangely moved by a fresh infilling of the Holy Ghost, 82 and 84 years of age. Who was the strange minister that we saw in the pulpit? Asked one of them. The minister replied, "Sure, I cannot tell you. But a certain minister from Glasgow has suggested that we invite A certain man I just been on the phone with this minister in Glasgow, and he referred to a man who saw a gracious movement in the city of Glasgow some little time ago. Well, I happen to be that man. This is something, dear people, that I just cannot understand. Why God in His mercy should have so directed that I should be called to visit the island of Lewis at that particular time. But I was glad that the college was prepared to release me for 10 days. It was agreed that I should go to a parish of Barbara for 10 days to conduct some meetings. Yes, they told me on the phone that there was a movement, that the churches were crowded with people, but as yet nothing had broken out that would favor or revival, other than a nameless was created among the people for the house of God. Well, I found myself on the pier in Stornoway, met by the minister and two of his officers there. Just as I stepped off the gangway, one of the office bearers came over to me and said, "Might I ask you a question before you go any further? Are you walking with God?" This is one of the men that prayed in the barn. This was one of the men to whom God had spoken. And there was a prayer about the ark of God in the palace. Are you walking with God? And I was glad that I was able to say to him, "Well, I fear God at any rate." If I had time, I would have told you of the gracious experience that I had in my own study, when God, in His mercy, met with me after 17 years of frustration and baffling as a minister, tired of it all, at the end of my struggle, at the end of all human resource, seeing so very little accomplished. And then God stepped into my life. "You needn't come to me at the close of this service and tell me that there's nothing in this talk about the baptism of the Holy Ghost." My dear people, to me, it's the most real thing. God coming down and God taking possession until the body so trembles that one with a frame, the human frame, could not contain God. Well, that is what happened to me. And in that realization and consciousness, I went to Lewis. And I'm now at the pier, and the minister is talking to me. "Yes, we're sure you're tired, Mr. Campbell, and possibly hungry. Well, there's a supper waiting for you at the man. But we wonder if you will address a meeting in the parish church at 9 o'clock tonight. Just on our way to the man, it will be a short meeting. We just want the people to know that you've come and that you're to minister to us for 10 days. Well, if you're interested to know that I never got that supper, and that instead of being on the island for 10 days, I was there for almost 4 years. We went to the church. A congregation of approximately 300 had gathered. It was a good meeting. There was a gracious sense of God. I preached for about an hour and a half. You see, in the Highlands, we believed in long sermon. I mustn't forget that I'm in Canada tonight and left work before midnight. Well, I lose the breath and the minister pronounced the benediction. The congregation leaves the church. Lying, walking down the aisle with this poor young man who fell into a trance in a barn. We're walking toward the door of the church. When he stood and looking up toward the heavens, he cried, "Go! You dare not kill us." Could you say that prayer? Could I say it? Ah, here is a man nearer to God than the man who stood in the pulpit. Here is a man who knew the secrets of the eternal. God, you made a promise. And I believe that you're a covenant keeping God that must be true to your covenant and wisdom. And I'm looking to you now to fulfill your promise. The pour water on the thirsty and blood upon the dry ground. To pray and continue praying for such half an hour. And then I saw the door of the church open. And the session clerk of the church coming in. Mr. Campbell, come to the door and see what's happened. See what's happened. Revival has surely come. There must be anything between 600 and 700 standing outside. A crowd of young people that were at a concert and dance in the village hall. Are outside here, and many of them are crying to God for nothing. Open the church again, open the church again, and let them in. The church was opened again, and this congregation walked in, crowded the church, in every corner, took the steps, the aisles, and the pulpit itself. So that I had difficulty in getting to the pulpit when I got there. I found a young woman, a school teacher, a graduate of Aberdeen University, lying flat on her face in the pulpit and asking, "Is there mercy for a sinner like me?" She was one of the parsons to me at the concert that night. But now on a face, crying to God for mass. That meeting continued until 4 o'clock in the morning. That's how I didn't get my touch. 4 o'clock, I'm leaving the church. A young man comes to me. God-fearing young man, but not a Christian. As I have said again and again, you can be God-fearing and not be a Christian. There are thousands of God-fearing people in the Highlands of Scotland who are not Christians. Spending church, conducting family worship, praying with their children, but they're not Christians. Oh, there's a difference. Let me say that you could gather all the natural goodness in the world into one grand whole. And you wouldn't have that which would constitute one Christian experience. Natural goodness is not Christian experience. A Christian is one who knows the experience of the Holy Ghost, bringing the personality of God to be incorporated in his personality. And suddenly discovering that heaven has invaded his soul and his supernatural office. This young man was a good living fellow. He came to me and said, "Mr. Campbell, there's something wonderful happening in the parish. There's a crowd of people at the police station. There must be anything between 300 and 400. I don't know where they come from, other than that a bus is here from another parish, and we can't understand it. They're in the police station, and some are weeping, and some are kneeling by the roadside, and some are crying to God for mercy. We cannot understand it. Why did they go to the police station? The police constable there is a God-fearing man. Next to the police station, the cottage where the two elderly sisters lived. Was that the magnetic power that drew them to the police station? I cannot say, but they were there. So I went along and saw a sight that gladdened my heart. Young men, old men, middle-aged men, and women, gripped by God, moved by the Holy Ghost that convicts of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. They're there on their faces, many of them, crying to God for masses. Were interested to know that seven of the young men who were saved that night are parish ministers today in the church.